But let's take a spin. When the control is pulled out like this, your car is in conventional gear. But for the thrill of effortless cruising, all it takes is a simple push of the conveniently located control to overdrive position. A touch of Ford's easy-to-reach starter button, and we're ready to go. An easy flick into second, and to third. For 95% of your driving, you'll not touch the lever again. Then, at any speed, over 27 miles per hour, you can ease up on the gas, and presto, the overdrive takes over, and your engine takes a rest. Uses 15% less gas, enjoys 30% less wear. You and your engine sit back and relax together for the smoothest ride you can imagine in the one fine car in its field. Now, suppose you need great acceleration, but fast. Tramp on it. A switch under the accelerator instantly puts your car into powerful, direct, high gear. And when the need for acceleration is past, just ease back on the gas. Overdrive takes over again. When you drive with overdrive, you drive with ease, with comfort, with assurance, with economy. For mile after mile, you economize with overdrive. The longer the trip, the greater the likelihood of even more economy. At least a gallon every 100 miles of ordinary driving, 2 gallons or more on long, steady runs. That's what overdrive does. And only Ford in its field offers overdrive and all that goes with it. Think what it would mean to you to save more than a gallon of gasoline every 100 miles. It's like buying a dollar's worth of gas for only 85 cents. Yes, Ford's overdrive is good to your engine and good to your pocketbook, whether you drive the powerful 6 or the even more powerful 8. And here's something even more impressive. Along with the economy of Ford's overdrive, you actually get increased acceleration when you call for it. Still greater than the zooming thrust which made Ford famous among all cars. Because Fords with overdrive have special ratio differentials, which actually increase the concentration of power delivered directly to the wheels without slippage for faster starting, harder pulling, and automatic instant surges of acceleration at any speed. But let's take a spin. When the control is pulled out like this, your car is in conventional gear. But for the thrill of effortless cruising, all it takes is a simple push of the conveniently located control to overdrive position. A touch of Ford's easy-to-reach starter button, and we're ready to go. An easy flick into second, and to third. For 95% of your driving, you'll not touch the lever again. Then at any speed, over 27 miles per hour, you can ease up on the gas, and presto, the overdrive takes over, and your engine takes a rest. Uses 15% less gas, enjoys 30% less wear. You and your engine sit back and relax together for the smoothest ride you can imagine in the one fine car in its field. Now, suppose you need great acceleration, but fast. Tramp on it. A switch under the accelerator instantly puts your car into powerful, direct, high gear. And when the need for acceleration is past, just ease back on the gas. Overdrive takes over again. When you drive with overdrive, you drive with ease, with comfort, with assurance, with economy. For mile after mile, you economize with overdrive.
Far and wide is done by companies, resourceful American industries, working together to serve everyone everywhere. Take this example, the Ford Motor Company. Ford can do the job simply because they know they're not big enough to build so complex a machine as an automobile without help. And an automobile is a complex machine. A machine that has to depend on thousands of interrelated parts working together smoothly. a machine that must give unfaltering service for years over tens of thousands of highway miles. You might take it for granted that your Ford car was built and assembled in Dearborn or the parts sent out to one of 15 branch plants for assembly. But because Ford needs the help of experts in hundreds of specialized lines of manufacture, it buys from other business enterprises a big share of the parts and assemblies that go into the car. Since Ford works closely with them all, with most of them on a year-in, year-out basis, these suppliers are really partners. 6,000 partners in all. 6,000 independent business enterprises, from one end of the country to the other. Given the brains, the skill, the designs and facilities, what is it that goes into the making of a car? It comes down to labor and raw materials. Everything that goes into a car involves both. Even iron ore, for example, involves the work of the men who get it out of the pit, the men who run the power shovels, the trucks and the locomotives at the iron mines of Minnesota and Michigan. Already you can see how the dollars are spreading out. To Utah and Montana, to the men who dig copper. To the Pacific Northwest, to the men who cut Port Orford cedar for battery separators. To the Middle West, to the farmers who grow corn and soybeans. To Missouri and Idaho, to the miners who dig out the lead for batteries. To Tennessee and Alabama for aluminum. To Kentucky and West Virginia for coal. To the Texas Panhandle for natural gas. To the Western Plains for leather and wool. To Louisiana for soda ash. To Michigan for limestone. To Maine for upholstery fabrics. Yes, the dollars are going out. To the men who operate the machines. To the girls who type the invoices and the bills of lading. They are all working and earning money. Because you are buying a car today. Because Ford long ago planned to produce that car. Some of the materials, take steel for example, have a lot of work involved in them. Value has been added. Steel suppliers have taken the basic materials, coke, limestone, and iron ore, and produced ingots and rolled them into sheets and bars. Dollars go to the companies who produce processed materials, but the largest percentage of the money ends up in the pay envelopes of the people who do the work. Some of the money with which you bought your new car is in those pay envelopes. Planning ahead for more new cars that will appear on the showroom floor months from now, buyers already are placing orders for finished parts, assemblies, and sub-assemblies. They deal with suppliers that are specialists in their field for parts like tires. Wherever a car goes, it goes on its tires. That's why tire making should be the concern of people who are tire experts. Spark plugs. Spark plugs bring the motor to life. For spark plugs, they go to manufacturers who have devoted themselves to spark plug building for years. The same applies to many other things purchased from suppliers. Batteries, speedometers, bumpers, seat springs, decorative hardware, grill parts, and things like roller bearings, heat control valves, automatic transmission assemblies, all the hundreds of other purchased items. And it doesn't stop with the parts that are to be assembled into the automobile. They have to be concerned with machine tools and office supplies, with items like crankshaft oil hole drilling machines that require 8 or 10 months to build, presses for stamping body parts from cold steel, gang drills for motor block castings. Some of the money that paid for your car went to the makers of each and every one of them.